So today I'm going to present a case, CVS case, and we have a volunteer here. So my patient's name is Rajesh. He is a 55-year-old male hailing from Ernakulam. He's a driver. Came with the chief complaints of acute onset of breathing difficulty since yesterday morning. History of presenting illness.
Can you tell me the reasons for acute onset of breathlessness?
It can be due to a lung pathology or due to a cardiovascular pathology. Lung, pneumothorax, acute exacerbation of asthma, COPD, pulmonary edema.
Okay.
CVS causes MI.
In children?
In children,
foreign body aspiration.
Foreign body aspiration. Okay.
Pulmonary embolism is another important cause in some patients. Okay. Not very common, but that also present with acute breathlessness.
Okay. So the patient who is a known case of systemic hypertension, not on any medication, presented with complaints of sudden onset of breathlessness since yesterday morning. Initially, he was able to do his daily activities without any difficulty, but later breathlessness progressively increased and the patient became breathless even at rest, NYHA grade 4. Yeah. Breathlessness was aggravated on lying down and patient was unable to complete even one sentence.
This patient is having orthopnea. So while taking history itself, we are feeling that this patient is uncomfortable on lying down posture. So what is the first thing you have to do whenever you come across this type of patients?
We have to make the patient
propped
sit upright.
Okay, please make the patient propped up. So that is very important. When you are when the patient is in propped up, what happens? He get more space to breathe. Okay, and his diaphragm will go down. Okay. So that is an advantage. So make the patient propped up so that it gives him improvement immediately. On top of that, the fluid accumulation in lungs will be more on the supine posture.
Mm. Okay. The breathlessness was also associated with palpitation.
Okay.
He also gives history of swelling of both lower limbs since 2 days. It was sudden in onset and swelling present up to calf. Progressively increased towards the end of the day, but was not relieved on elevation of the limbs. No history of pain in legs, no history of prolonged immobilization. There is history of abdominal distension since 3 days and it was associated with loss of appetite. No history of nausea, vomiting, loose stool, reduced urine output or abdominal pain. Patient gives history of sore throat and fever 2 weeks back and he was tested for COVID-19 and it was negative. And fever was high grade and continuous and also there was dry cough. And watery discharge from nose lasted for 1 week, after which he developed generalized tiredness. The breathlessness was not associated with fever, cough, wheezing or hemoptysis. No history of headache or blurring of vision or loss of consciousness. No history of chest pain, sweating or nausea. That's the history. Past history, no history of any cardiac illness or no history of similar episodes in the past.
Yeah.
Personal history, mixed diet, normal sleep and appetite, normal bowel bladder habit, not habituated to smoking or alcohol. Family history, no history of cardiac illnesses in family. Drug history, not on any medication. Now, examination.
Yes. You have any differential diagnosis in your mind? Always make a differential diagnosis when you finish the history so that it will be easy for you.
Okay, so
somebody is having orthopnea. You fix the diagnosis in cardiac disease. Most of the time, it is due to cardiac failure. Okay, you may get lot of things which may go in favor of a lung disease. But somebody is having orthopnea. Most probably, it is cardiac failure. Rarely, somebody can have orthopnea even in COPD or asthma. Hmm. But it classically represents a cardiac failure.
Hmm.
Okay, this patient had a sore throat. Some difficulty in like cough and all that might have aggravated the cardiac problem, that illness.
Mm.
Okay, that's all. Okay, but mostly it is a cardiac disease.
Okay, so examination, general examination, patient is conscious, oriented, and dyspneic.
Okay.
Well built and nourished, height 170 cm, weight 65 kg, BMI 22.5. No pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing or lymphadenopathy. There is bilateral pedal edema. Pitting pedal edema.
Pitting pedal edema indicates fluid overload. There are a lot of other causes. Pitting pedal edema always indicate a fluid overload. Okay. Which heart failure, right or left?
Right heart.
It indicates right heart failure, but a left heart failure in turn can lead to right heart failure. Okay.
Okay. Vitals, BP is 200 over 90 mmHg. Pulse 113 per minute, irregularly irregular.
Irregular pulse indicates what?
Atrial fibrillation.
Okay, atrial fibrillation with 130 heart rate. That is very important. Heart rate is very high, irregular pulse. BP is also high, 200 by 90. How do you check the BP in a patient who is having atrial fibrillation? Single reading is enough?
No, sir.
The BP will alter beat by beat. Okay. In one beat, it may be 200 by 90. Another beat, it may be 190 by 100. Another beat, it may be 80 by 40. Like that, it will be varying. So minimum, when you are examining a patient with atrial fibrillation, minimum 3 readings you have to take an average. Or continuously monitor BP like this with monitor or arterial line, then only you get proper BP. Whatever it is, this patient has got a high BP, irregular heartbeat with high heart rate. Okay. When there is a high heart rate, what will happen to the ejection fraction?
It will reduce.
The pumping will reduce because there is no filling properly. So it can reduce. So our main aim in this patient will be control the breathing problem, control the heart rate. These are the two main things once you finish the discussion. Okay.
So his respiratory rate was 32 per minute.
Okay.
And saturation was 84%.
Okay.
And he is afebrile. Temperature
okay.
is normal.
Okay. So immediately once you diagnose this patient's saturation is low, what you do?
You have to give high flow oxygen.
So you have to start oxygen. You want to start with nasal prongs, mask?
Nasal mask.
So we have to start with mask. Please start the mask. So mask advantage is more than 4 liter you can give. So this patient may require 6 liter or 7 liter. So we have to give with mask. Otherwise what will happen? You give only oxygen, there will be complete washout of carbon dioxide. So that also create problem. So we have to put the patient on mask. So we will start the patient immediately now itself. We have to start because you have made a diagnosis of hypoxemia. So we start with oxygen, then we will discuss. Okay. So the EMT will start on oxygen. Please start. Give. So we'll start the oxygen. We'll connect with the this one. So we remove this one and we start. Okay.
Okay.
If the patient does not improve with your oxygenation currently, with the high flow oxygen through this normal mask, what is the next thing?
Nasal prong.
Next you have to go for BiPAP ventilation because we are giving high flow oxygen through this. Okay. Patient is not improving. We have to start BiPAP. Okay, that we will discuss afterwards. So anyway, we have started oxygen mask. Through mask. That is very important. So we should not keep the patient without oxygen in this type of conditions. Okay.
So examination, systemic examination, respiratory system, inspection, trachea is central, apical impulse is in fifth intercostal space lateral to the midclavicular line, chest movement is reduced bilaterally, no scars, dilated veins or swellings. Palpation, no local rise in temperature or tenderness, trachea is central, apex beat is in fifth intercostal space, 1 cm lateral to midclavicular line. Chest expansion is only 3 cm, it's okay. reduced, and movement is reduced. Vocal fremitus is normal. Percussion impaired, not in the lower segments.
Okay.
Auscultation, air entry is bilaterally equal. Vesicular breath sounds, bilateral basal crepitations are present.
Okay. What do you mean by bilateral basal crepitation?
Both lungs.
And when the patient is sitting up, okay, that is the ideal position to auscultate. Sitting up, auscultate on the back, posterior aspect, you get crepitation. That indicates what?
Fluid in the alveoli.
It mostly indicates fluid overload. Okay. Even you can get in pneumonia, bilateral pneumonia, you can get same type of crepitation. But the given patient, given history, more suitable diagnosis, bilateral basal crepitation means pulmonary edema. Okay.
CVS examination. Inspection, JVP is elevated,
okay.
4 cm above.
How do you look for JVP normally?
Ask the patient to line 45 degree.
So this is 45 degree, turn the patient to neck opposite side. Then now you can see the pulsations in the jugular venous, this one, pulse. And you have to measure the jugular venous pulsation from the
external ankle.
Okay, that should be done. And if you are not getting, suppose in a failing heart, you are not getting pulsations as you expected, what do you do? you can go for hepatojugular reflex. Press on the abdomen slowly and you can see the pulsations are elevated. In a normal person, it will come back to normal position. But in a patient who is having failing heart, somebody is on Lasix, fluid is removed. In that patient, if you press here, you can see the persistence of the pulsations. Okay. That is very important in cardiac failure patient because most of the patients might have received the injections. Mm. Okay.
Shape of the chest is normal. There is no epigastric or suprasternal pulsations. Apical impulse is shifted outwards and downwards.
That indicates what? Apical impulse is shifted outwards and downwards.
Left ventricular hypertrophy.
It indicates an enlargement of heart, not a hypertrophy. Hypertrophy means within the limits the thickness has occurred. The heart muscles are thick, the chamber has reduced. But dilatation means it is like a balloon. It is going out and down. Okay. So that indicates left ventricular dilatation than hypertrophy. Ultimately, hypertrophy may lead to dilatation, but here in a case, given case, it indicates the dilatation of the ventricle.
Shape of the pericardium is normal, no bulge or visible pulsation, no dilated veins or scar. Palpation, no local rise in temperature, tenderness, apex beat is shifted, no left parasternal heave, no epigastric pulsation or supraclavicular pulsation, no thrill. Percussion, left cardiac border correspond to the apex, second intercostal space is resonant. Auscultation, S1, S2 heard, no added sounds, okay, no
which murmurs. Is the most important added sound in a cardiac failure? S3. Third heart sound in left ventricle is most important. That indicates a failing heart. Okay. So if you are not hearing it also okay, but if you are hearing it, you have to document it.
Okay, sir. GA examination, inspection, abdomen is distended, umbilicus is averted, flanks
GA examination, which is most important examination finding in a case
hepatomegaly.
Hepatomegaly and ascites, that is very important. Some patients can have liver tenderness. Okay.
Palpation, no rise in temperature or tenderness, liver, no hepatosplenomegaly, no renal angle tenderness, there is dullness on percussion and shifting dullness is also present. Auscultation, breath, bowel sounds are present.
So some ascites is there, some liver enlargement is there, that indicates fluid overload. Okay.
CNS examination, higher mental functions are intact, cranial nerves normal. Motor system normal, reflexes superficial deep present, sensory system also normal.
Okay. So what is your diagnosis in this case?
It can be biventricular failure.
That is cardiac congestive heart failure. That is the diagnosis. Biventricular failure, all these things, we have to go for further investigation like echo and all. So this patient is having cardiac failure, mostly congestive heart failure. And patient has got left ventricular failure finding also because he is unable to lie down. Okay, so this patient, like you told, it can be biventricular failure mostly, but we have to confirm it by echo. Okay. So that's okay. Now, how do you treat this patient? What are the basic investigation you do in emergency room?
First, we have to measure saturation, vitals.
So saturation, you have done it. It is 84. Then we have started on oxygen with face mask. Patient did not improve. So when you are taking care of the patient's airway, breathing, circulation, what is the next step? Patient did not improve with a simple face mask.
So BiPAP.
So you can keep the BiPAP. Ideally, we should keep. So this is BiPAP. So this will be kept for this patient. So what is the advantage of BiPAP in pulmonary edema?
It
gives a positive pressure. Mm-hmm. Both inspiration and expiration gives a positive pressure so that the alveoli will be opened up. The fluid will be displaced. Okay. And when the patient breathing out, it produces some pressure so that air will not go out very fast. Okay. So with the BiPAP, we can maintain the saturation. Okay. This patient is fully conscious. We can maintain this patient on BiPAP. Only problem in this type of patient, there may be some hypotension that we should take care. Okay. So we have started BiPAP. Patient has clinically improved. Okay. So airway has improved. Okay. With BiPAP. Next is what?
Circulation.
Airway, breathing is over. Now circulation. What is the problem in circulation?
He's having hypertension.
He is having high BP and high heart rate. It is atrial fibrillation. How do you manage this? This patient has got cardiac failure clinically. This patient has got pulmonary edema. This patient has got high BP. This patient has got high heart rate, but it is irregular. So you have to control the BP so that heart can pump against a low pressure area. Okay, now heart is unable to pump because BP is high, and the heart rate is very high, so the pumping capacity will come down because the diastolic time is reduced. So you have to control both. How do you control it?
For hypertension, we can give NTG.
So we have to give some drug which act immediately. Okay. So this patient has got fluid overload. How do you treat this patient?
Last six.
So you have to give furosemide. So give furosemide. How much you want to give?
For first, give. Start with 40 milligrams.
So we will give 40. Give the last six ampule. So this is last six ampule. How much you want to give?
40. We'll start with 40.
Okay. So this contains 40 milligram. We'll give this injection. So, IV or IM? This injection should be given IV or IM?
IV.
IV. So, we should give IV. Okay. So, take the IV and give it. Okay. So, the EMT will give IV. Okay. IV last 6, 40 milligram we are given. Okay. So, it can be given as bolus. What is the disadvantage of bolus? It may reduce BP slightly further. Okay. So, you can give initial bolus, then you can start as an infusion. Last 6 infusion can be given. That will not reduce the BP, that removes the fluid. Okay. But what problem it can produce? You are giving last 6. What problem it can produce?
Heart failure is all.
It can produce urination. This patient has to go for urination. So, better to catheterize. If the patient is unable to walk, catheterize the patient, give last 6. Or make arrangement for that. Bedside urinal can be given because patient cannot go to bathroom. So that should be given, give last 6. Take care that problem, then give last 6. So BP will come down, fluid will be displaced. Okay, then you have started BiPAP. But we have to control the BP. What drug can be given?
NTG.
NTG infusion should be started for this patient. So that can be 5 or 10 microgram depending on the BP. We have to start NTG infusion. What is the advantage of NTG?
Rapid onset of action.
That dilates the peripheral circulation. Again, heart can pump very easily, and coronary circulation also it increases. Okay. It even reduces the BP. Okay. So always NTG is the ideal drug for this patient. But he has got atrial fibrillation with rapid ventricular rate. How do you control it? What is the BP you told? BP is high.
Yes.
Heart rate is high. There is atrial fibrillation. How do you treat it? You have to control the rate. How do you control the rate? The drugs like beta blockers, diltiazem, verapamil, or even amiodarone, all these things can be started according to ACLS protocol. If since the BP is good, we can start any of this drug. Can we give beta blocker in this patient?
No, sir, because already breathlessness is there.
Breathlessness is not a contraindication for beta blocker. Only asthma or beta blocker induced asthmatic patients, we should avoid this. This breathlessness is due to heart problem, okay, heart disease. So if you can control the heart rate, the problem will come down. So we can start beta blocker, 5 milligram can be started. You have to ask the history of asthma or anything like that. We can start diltiazem, we can start verapamil. Only thing, if there is on echo, if there is a heart failure, then the failure may aggravate. So you should be very careful when you are starting this type of drugs. Okay, but since the patient's BP is very good, there is no major problem can be produced by these drugs. We can start beta blocker, diltiazem or verapamil depending on the availability. So that should be given, and the heart rate should be controlled. The rhythm will not be controlled. Atrial fibrillation will not be controlled unless and we start a drug for controlling the rhythm. Okay, that will not target in emergency room. We are only targeting control the BP, control the rate. Okay, so that is done. Then what is next? So his airway, breathing, circulation part is taken care. Now we have to go for investigation. How do you know that this patient problem is heart failure or something else?
First we can take ECG.
So we'll take an ECG that shows atrial fibrillation with rapid ventricular rate. Okay, so that is confirmed. Now you should know what are the reasons for atrial fibrillation. Then only you can investigate. What are the reasons? We divide that into cardiac and non-cardiac. What are the non-cardiac conditions?
Medications.
Medications. Most important is hyperthyroidism. So thyroid function test should be done when you are investigating. So thyroid dysfunction and all causes for atrial enlargement, MS, MR, hypertensive heart disease, then any cardiomyopathies, all these things, alcohol intake, all these things can produce atrial fibrillation. So look for atrial fibrillation causes. Then, so you have taken an ECG, you understood that atrial fibrillation is there. Then?
So, blood investigations.
For that, you have to do an echo. Okay. So because we are giving this many drugs like beta blocker, diltiazem, or verapamil is given. Before that, ideally, you have to do an echo in emergency room, rule out the failure part. Okay. Mm-hmm. Clinically, we are not seeing any left ventricular failure. This failure is due to high BP. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, control the BP, failure will come down. But however, we have to see what is ejection fraction, what any regional wall motion abnormalities are there. All should be ruled out by an echo. Mm-hmm. So, echo should be done for this patient. Mm-hmm. Then?
Then we can do
blood. We have to ask for one important blood test. What is
BNP.
That? BNP. BNP should be done before doing any other investigation because BNP can be elevated in cardiac failure. Suppose this is pulmonary edema, BNP may not be elevated. Pulmonary edema, secondary cardiac failure can occur. There you can get BNP elevation. But normally, somebody who come with COPD or asthma, they may not have elevation BNP. So ideally, we have to do a BNP levels. If it is high, cardiac failure diagnosis can be done. What else you can do?
Then I want to check blood itself, is there a
anemia? Anemia is one of the important cause for cardiac failure. So anemia should be ruled out. Then anything else you want to do? X-ray? X-ray is a basic investigation which is very important because everywhere you don't get echo or BNP. So take an X-ray, rule out pneumonia and see that bilateral congestion can be there in X-ray, cardiomegaly can be there. Mm-hmm. So that should be done. Okay, then?
Then ultrasound abdomen.
Ultrasound abdomen is done for what?
Hepatomegaly,
ascites. So clinically you are making a diagnosis. So ultrasound may not be indicated, but for a completion sake you can ask, but it is not an indicated investigation in emergency room. Mm-hmm. Okay, then? So this patient has improved. Mm-hmm. Okay, improved after your treatment with LASIX. Beta blockers and NTG, patient has improved. Mm. This patient will be shifted to ward or discharged later. What are the drugs which can be given for a patient who is having this type of problems?
Since the patient is having atrial fibrillation, we can give anticoagulants, warfarin.
So warfarin should be started. Warfarin takes minimum 7 days to act. So before that, you have to add some other drug.
Low molecular weight heparin.
You have to start heparin or low molecular weight heparin. Then 7 days, you continue that. Along with the heparin, you start warfarin. After 7 days, discontinue heparin and continue warfarin. So warfarin or similar drug should be started to prevent blood clots in the atrium or ventricle?
Atrium.
It is in the atrium. The blood clots are formed in the atrium in atrial fibrillation because atrium contracts like this. So you have to start warfarin. Okay. When you are starting warfarin, what are the investigation to follow up? PTINR should be followed up. Okay, so PTINR should be done at least every 3 days. Then afterwards, on follow-up days, patient has to do that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that should be started. So one is warfarin and heparin. Then
for hypertension.
Hypertension, BP should be controlled. What drug is ideal for this patient? He has got atrial fibrillation, high BP, high heart rate. So what is the ideal drug?
ACE inhibitors?
AC inhibitors will not control the heart rate. It prevents the ventricular remodeling. That should be started, but here this patient may require beta blocker because heart rate is very high, atrial fibrillation is there. So beta blocker may be ideal drug. AC inhibitor should be added to avoid ventricular dilatation. So you can give a combination of beta blocker with AC inhibitor or ARB. LASIX. Crucemate should be started for anyway till the patient improves. Clinically, we have to continue LASIX or furosemide. Anything else you want to do? Any other drug you want to give? So we have to do other investigation. Why this patient has developed hypertension? Why the patient is having heart disease? You have to do cholesterol tests, thyroid function tests. So other investigation should be done. Any treatment required for that also should be given. Okay. So this patient has come with high BP, atrial fibrillation with pulmonary edema. So we have treated all these things. When we are discharging, atrial fibrillation should be taken care. Can any of these drugs what we discussed can control the fibrillation part?
Rate can be controlled.
Rhythm cannot be controlled. If you are starting amiodarone, rhythm may be controlled with that. Otherwise, we have to shift this patient for specialized therapy like electrophysiological ablation or something like that. So that should be done, that this patient should be referred to cardiology for complete evaluation of why this patient has developed atrial fibrillation. That should be controlled. Okay. Thank you.